Good morning, church family. An exciting day. We're glad that you're here. It's good to see everyone, especially John. I hear you, John. Hey, we're going to invite you to stand this morning, and this is a time to celebrate God's love, His mercy, His grace, His goodness. And this is a weekend where we celebrate independence and freedom, but we know we have ultimate freedom when we turn our lives over to Jesus Christ. The chains have been broken, and we can continue to follow and walk in the Spirit of God. Hey, we're going to invite you to stand. Did I already do that? I invited you to stand. I'm going to invite you to sing without holding back, knowing that we are free, knowing that we can lift our hands and praise a God who is so good. We can dance before Him, and may we do that today. Let's sing. Come on, let's get those holy hands clapping this morning.
Through you the dead will rise, through you all hearts will praise, through you the darkness flees, through you my heart screams, I am
free. And we are a nation that is truly blessed, but I know we've seen trouble lately, and it seems like there's a lot of division, but may God give us strength in these difficult times as we sing these next songs, knowing that God has always shed His grace on us. He's always been good and merciful. Let's sing.
My country tears of the sweet land of liberty of thee I say. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrim's pride, from every mountainside, let freedom ring.
Oh, beautiful, oh, spacious as
our nation. Friends, can we pray together this morning? That's right. We need you, Lord. We need you, Lord. We need you. And it feels like our nation is lost right now. And there's a lot of confusion, a lot of confusion, Lord. People are not knowing what to do. I don't know. That is the big thing we're saying. We're uncertain of things, but we are certain of you, that you love us, that you care about us, each person, each child. And we know who you are, our Father in heaven, our Father of heavenly lights. We praise you this morning, and we know you're good. We know you have a plan. We know there's a purpose, Lord. And we know that all this evil thing, stuff that's happening in our world today that you can use, it for good. Only you can do that. And Lord, we're going to ask you, yes, to turn it around. May people come to know you through this chaos and the circumstances going on in our nation right now. I pray that you would be the one that would change hearts and that many would fall on their knees and declare that Jesus is Lord, because we know, Lord Jesus, you are the answer. You are the only answer. You are the one who can rescue. You and you alone can save us. And we're asking you to bring unity within our country, Lord. We're praying for our leaders. We might not agree with everything that they say, but we know we need to come together and figure things out. But may it be your will. May it be by your might, not ours, Lord. Holy Spirit, we ask you to be here this morning. We invite you into our minds. We invite you into our hearts and ask you to change us. You know the things that we come with and the things that we carry and the things that are burdens in our hearts. We want to release it all to you, knowing that you have us, knowing that we can trust, and trust you more today. We love you. We want to honor you, not just on a Sunday morning, but as we walk each day, we want to look to you and know you more, because you are the one, Lord Jesus, that has set us free and gives us new life and new beginnings. We love you. We praise you. We give you honor. It's in Jesus' name. Amazing grace. God is good. He's always been good. He always will be good. He never changes. Hey, we're glad you're here this morning. We're going to give you a 10-second greeting to wave to all our friends and family. Hey, if you're online watching, we're glad that you're connecting with us in some way. We love you, and we're glad that you're here. And 5 seconds, 4 seconds, 3 seconds, 2. And your time is up. Social distancing, isn't it wonderful? Yes. trying to do the best we can. That's all we can do is the best. Did somebody just say whatever? Did I? All in fun. Hey, we're glad you're here, friends. We have some announcements and things, some highlights we want to share with you, some things coming up, even some things about missions. So we're going to ask you to turn your eyes and attention to the big screens. Enjoy.
Giving to your local church should be easy. And with Tithely, it is. Just download the app and securely register your credit or debit card. You're done. Now you can give during church services or anywhere else. Use Tithely to give a one-time gift or set up recurring donations. It's that simple. It's fast, secure, and easy to use. Tithely, the simplest way to give to your local church.
Ladies, on the second Saturdays of the month, we have a women's prayer breakfast. It starts at 9 a.m., and we'd like to invite you all to come and join us for fellowship, fun, and great food. Thanks.
If anyone would like to participate in the Christmas play, No Room at the Inn this year, please contact Bobby Frasca. She can be found in the church directory or by calling the church office. There are a lot of available parts, and each part will be working virtually from home for the time being. This is a drama, and each part does not have a lot of lines, and she has chosen this play to allow anyone who is interested to be involved with ease. The dates of the play this year will be December 3rd, 4th, and 5th. So if you're interested, don't hesitate to reach out to Bobby Frasca.
I'm the product of the missionary coming in Africa with the gospel. My grandfather was a witch doctor, and he became Jesus' lover, and he brought the gospel to his family. And I realized that it was important to bring God's love to every human being. And I can easily see how we can reach the remaining people groups by the churches that have been prepared by the Holy Spirit, so Jesus can come very soon. I see God's power working when we are doing evangelization. People are healed. Blind people see. And God doesn't use it to glorify the evangelization team, but to show to those who are listening that He's really on the lead. It's a kind of testimony. And all the glory is given to God. I want the Holy Spirit to allow planting of a church among all the unreached people, because this is what is said in the Revelation, that all tongue, all people group will be in front of the throne to worship. And this can only happen if people are willing to go on the field to do the work. As the Bible said, we are the light, we are the salt, and it cannot be hidden, and all the glory is given to God. Praise be to the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
And if you haven't downloaded the First Christian Church app, it's very simple. Head right on over to the website, scroll down to the bottom of the first page where you can download the app to your Apple or Android device to make sure that you stay connected with all the happenings around FCC.
Can I ask the elders to come up? If you've been a part of a church over the years, usually when the elders and pastors are up front, it means someone just got fired. But that's not what's happening today. No one's leaving. The minister's not leaving. I hope that you're not sad about that, but happy about that. But hey, a couple things. We want to be ever more a missions-minded church. If America chooses a different direction, then God's eyes are still on the world, and we want to support these other nations and love and pray. Will you say amen? So this fall, you're going to see as we become much more deeply connected to world missions and what's going on with that. Please read through your bulletin today. We ask you to fill out the little prayer card. We have a prayer meeting tonight at 6 o'clock here at the church. Also Thursday morning at 7 a.m. We have things going on. We believe in social distancing, but part of that's because the numbers are dropping so much. So you'll be safe, we believe you'll be safe with God, and we invite you all week long to be here and be a part of these things that's going on. I'm even going to Sunsplash at the end of the month because the coronavirus cannot live in that nasty water. So planning on doing that. So please check through your bulletin and be a part of that. Friends, part of this thing with masks, my nephew out in Arizona, he's a pastor in Arizona. The church there came up with the brilliant idea that they're going to force everybody in church to wear a mask. Over half the church quit last week. They quit. They're done. They're not going to be a part of that fellowship. You can't make people do things like that. So we're trying to be careful. We're trying not to touch. We're trying to wear a mask out of love for other people, even though after 6 hours, I'm very, very tired of this mask on Sunday morning. But we're just asking you to think about others and think about them and where they're at and what they're doing. Hey, we're going to take a moment to do something that's very important. You probably have not seen this often in your life. By the way, our church, our sermons are on Jesus Radio Worldwide, JRWW.com. 149 different nations. The word's going out now, and it's very exciting that God opened that. 149, JesusRadioWorldwide.com. Got it. So working on that. Nowadays, I'm not trying to be mean. Most people flee from heavy responsibility. We're basically saying I'm very busy, and now we have this terrible fear. So today we want to push back on that and do something entirely different. We want to have part of an ordination. Now, the first part, it comes to you, and I ask you this question. Brethren, recognizing God's plan for the church, it places elders in the place of leadership under Jesus and over the local congregation. We have sought out from our midst men of faith and consecration to serve as our bishops. That's the Greek word for overseers. They oversee spiritual matters. The scriptures set forth the qualifications and duties of these spiritual leaders. That's why most men will always say, I'm not worthy. I can't do it. I'm not good enough. I don't match up. That's all I ever hear people say. We make it clear that we're supposed to uphold, love, and respect elders in their work. For this reason, I'm asking you right now, those who are members of this local congregation, will you follow the leadership of these men in all things that pertain to life and godliness as they seek to lead us to a richer service for the Lord? If you are willing to do that, please answer as a congregation, we will. All right. And right now, this is for all of us. Charlie Kellenberger's back teaching a Sunday school class right now. But this is for each one, but especially this is to Dean, the man right here in the middle. Dean, this is a day for humility. Actually, I don't know when that changes. I don't know when it's not a time for humility. The congregation has just confirmed you the responsible office, the side of heaven. It is, I believe, the biggest office, the side of heaven. They place trust in you. Boys and girls and men and women, they're always watching us. Their eyes are always on us. That's a heavy burden, Dean. That's a responsibility. My sermon next week talks about that and how they're always watching us. They always see and they're always trying to understand. The leadership that are developed in the Christian life, you're supposed to be made useful for the Lord. The Lord is counting on you to guide and care and love. And Dean, that's why you're already an elder. For a year and a half, Dean has been prepared and watched us and watched him. So we're asking you this question, which I believe is going to be replayed in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Dean, we ask you, will you promise before God and these witnesses that you will sanctify yourself? You're looking to God for wisdom, that you will, to the best of your ability, minister in the spirit of Jesus, and you'll look after the responsibilities that relate to your service. If you will do that, will you answer by saying, I will?
I
going to ask Bob Bird to say something, then we're going to pray over Dean.
Don't kneel yet, Dean. As I suspected that this might happen, so I started to read a little bit about what elders are supposed to do. And I saw stuff and I said, uh-oh, really? Oh, come on. And so there was a lot. And the one thing that Dean, as you go about doing your ministry, it's kind of like the fellow and his son who were riding the donkey into town. Okay, and the first day the son says, hey, Dad, you go ahead and ride. I'll lead the donkey. So they went to town. And some of the people criticized him and said, hey, look at that lazy old man making his son work. Next day they decided they were going to fix it. So the dad led the donkey into town. Lo and behold, some people said the same thing again. Hey, look at that old man. Wait a minute, where was I? Kid? Who's walking? The old man, right? Okay. All right, I got it now. So they said, look at that lazy kid making his dad ride the donkey into town. And then the third day, he said, we're going to fix it. And so they both rode the donkey into town. And some of the people said, hey, look at that. They're going to break that donkey's back. So the fourth day, they said, hey, we're going to fix this. And this would be like you coming into town, and the two of them are walking with a donkey. And the people, some of the people look and say, look at those, look at that stupid people. Okay, they're walking in, they got a perfectly good donkey they could ride. So now do we want them to kneel as we lay hands on now? We heard from Uncle Charlie in the previous session, and what Uncle Charlie pointed out was Dean's military service. And Dean offered his life in service of his country and did an excellent job in the Marines. And when he came to become an elder, he applied that same dedication, which you often see in the military, the same dedication to serving God here. He's done it for the last, as Pastor Keith said, year and a half, and doing prayer ministry and doing hospital visits. Kind of dangerous to go in hospitals because you never know what you're going to walk out with, but yet he did it in faith. The enemy hates this dedication right now. There's a large target going on your back, and the enemy will try to destroy you and your ministry. But the good news, when you accept Jesus Christ, that the Holy Spirit is within you, and greater than he that is in you than he that is in the world. Not one of your brothers laying hands on you right now is perfect. Not one. We are all charged to grow and mature in Christ. We are to seek the Holy Spirit in all we do. Every meeting that you go to, every decision that you make, to go first to the Holy Spirit. All too often, we depend upon our so-called wisdom. All politics aside, seek the Holy Spirit. Every man up here is pleased to call you an elder. Now let's close with prayer. Heavenly Father, we pray that you would be with Dean as you have been. Bless Bonnie as well, yes. Without a wife serving and allowing all the things that Dean has to do, it almost would be an impossible task. So we give praise and thanks for Bonnie. And guide and protect him, Lord. Don't let the enemy destroy him and pull him away. We're asking for a special blessing on Dean, that he would grow in the Spirit. In Jesus' precious name.
I stand for the flag, number one, because it represents the foundation of this country. It's the freedom and the independence, the self-reliance and the accountability. And this is one nation that was created under God.
I mean, it's freedom. It's home. It's every sacrifice that's been made by every man and woman that's fought to defend it.
America is freedom. You know, we have the opportunity to live free. You know, every time we go to a rodeo to compete, we get to stand for the flag and remember that.
The American flag has withstanded war after war after war. It's been tattered, it's been tested, and it truly stands as the greatest image of America.
Well, there's a lot of people that didn't get to come home, that don't get to stand. Part of standing is standing for them.
There's graveyards all over the United States filled with men and women that didn't have that opportunity that we have. And we can't take it lightly.
No matter where the enemy takes them, foreign, domestic, it doesn't matter. They're willing to go through the hells that it takes to keep us free. And yet the only thing that we're asked to do to honor them is to stand up and honor the flag, you know, that they fought for.
I don't do it out of obligation. I don't do it because I'm told. I don't do it because I was trained. I don't do it to be bold. I stand for our national anthem because I'm forever grateful to be free. I stand for the anthem to respect those before me. We have wounded warriors who would return only if they could. Doing more for this country than any single person should. Stand up. Their lives were given for you. So as long as the Star-Spangled Banner yet wave, I stand for the land of the free and the home of the brave.
Listen very carefully to these words as they are now on the screen.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming. And the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air,
seated. I want to begin today with a verse of scripture that we need to keep in mind. These are the words of Jesus in John chapter 8. You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Yesterday, July the 4th, we as a nation celebrated our 244th anniversary of the signing of the Declaration of Independence. That's right. And with that in mind, it is my intent today to bring to our attention some of the past, but even more than that, what you and I have been given as we live in this country today. There's some very important things I want to bring out concerning the approximate 250 men that we call our founding fathers. Now, you know, in recent years, and we've all heard this, where people are saying that our founding fathers were just a group of atheists, agnostics, or at the best, deists. But all you have to do is just look at the abundant history and information that is available to show to us that just is not true. A careful investigation shows that these 250 plus men, out of that group, there were only 12 who did not associate themselves with a local church or some form of Christianity. In other words, of all of our founding fathers, less than 5% of them had no relationship with Jesus Christ. Those 250 men included the 52 who signed our Declaration of Independence, and more than 50 of them signed the Constitution of the United States. But more than 150 of them wrote ample information, letters, documents, theses about what they had in mind in bringing this nation into existence. I said this first service, you're going to have to apologize. I have to apologize to you. I've just been put on some new medication, and my mouth is really dry. I apologize. Years ago, I had this happen, and one of the elders of the church came to me and said, "That's the first time I ever saw a windmill run on water." Gotta watch those guys. We all know about our first president, George Washington. And if you will just do a simple research reading of his documents, you will find that he had a tremendous faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and how this nation had come into existence. Let me ask you to listen to the second president of the United States, John Adams. Adams said this: the general principles on which the fathers achieved independence were the general principles of Christianity. I will avow that I then believed and now believe that those general principles of Christianity are as essential and as immutable as the existence and attributes of God himself. I came across something a number of years ago that I thought was astounding. There was a 10-year-long study done by the political science department of the University of Houston, Texas. What they did, they wanted to know what was the guiding principle behind the thinking of our founding fathers. What caused them to say these things, write these things, and do these things? So they went through more than 15,000 documents that had been written by our founding fathers. These documents consisted of at least 2,000 words. And this is what they found. In all of those documents, 34% of the content of those documents were direct quotes from the Word of God, the Bible. That's what was forming their views. That's what brought their thinking into this position. So before we turn our attention to the wording of the Declaration of Independence, I would have you to look at the total picture of it. Now, on the back of your bulletin, I've just given you a very small part. I've given to you the four God statements that are contained in the Declaration. I've had a lot of people say, well, you know, there's no God statement. There are four. And all you have to do is just look and see them. But I'd like for you, all of us, to try to do something here. Try to, in your mind, go back to the way people lived in the late 1700s here on this country. You realize that we were just a small group of little colonies still under the authority and the rule of the King of England. Now, even with the high taxation and the problem of the fact that here we are over here and our authority is over there, the vast population of this country were Christian people who wanted to follow the law of God, and they remained faithful to the crown. So one of the fundamental reasons for this loyalty was the way the Bible teaches us to honor the king, to live according to the law. Now, if you stop and think about it this way, though, you realize this is one of the reasons why so many people today don't know what the Constitution or what the Declaration of Independence is all about. I would invite you this afternoon to go home, get a copy of the Declaration, and read through it for yourself. It's not that long. It's not a hard read. You can easily take care of that in about 5-7 minutes. But refresh your memory on this. The Bible is very clear teaching us about citizenship. Listen to what we read in Romans 13. Everyone must submit himself to the governing authorities. For there's no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. Consequently, he who rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted. And those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers hold no terror to those who do right, but for those who do wrong. Do you want to be free from the fear of the one in authority? Then do what is right, and he will commend you. Now, quite honestly, passages like this help us to understand why our founding fathers wrote such an in-depth, precise declaration. They were clearly stating that the reason we are doing this is because of the violations the king had brought against us and against the teachings of the Word of God. You see, our founding father just couldn't send a note over to England saying, sorry, Georgie boy, we don't like you and we just quit. Didn't work that way. In fact, understand this also. The Declaration of Independence was not written just to the people who live here. It was a statement to the world, because never in the history of mankind had anything like this ever happened. Here we were as a people saying, we're not going to be under the king. We're going to be responsible directly to God. We, the people. That's what our Constitution says. Now, our founding fathers knew that this was not a rebellion against God. It was a declaration of God. And that's why we need to see it again today. Let me bring to your attention a couple of things here today. I want to show you one of the God statements. Look at the very opening paragraph of the Declaration of Independence. The first paragraph reads this way. When in the course of human events, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them to another, and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God, now remember that, nature's God, entitles them, a decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to the separation. Now, I can't answer for you, but there's no way you can read this opening statement without realizing this is a God statement. Here is a statement saying that we are relying on nature's God. The very first sentence is declaring in our declaration that Almighty God, the Lord God Almighty, is called upon as the justification for our separation from the British Empire. Now, let's give this some serious thought here for a moment. I'd like to bring to your attention what it means by the laws of nature. Sir William Blackstone was a British justice and scholar of the British laws of that day. Now get this, in 1768, 8 years before we declared ourselves as an independent people, Blackstone published his commentary on the law. This was used as the basis of interpretation of the law in England and in America for more than 150 years until early 1900s. Now, I want to read to you a statement that Blackstone makes. Now, this may sound like legalese, but think this thing through. He's talking about God here, and he says this. This will of his maker, talking about God, is called the laws of nature. For as God, when he created matter and endued it with the principle of mobility, established certain rules for the perpetual direction of that motion, so that he, when he created man and endued him with free will to conduct himself in all parts of life, he laid down certain immutable laws of nature, whereby that free will is in to some degree regulated and restricted. Now, what Blackstone is saying here, God created everything, and he created a standard, a value, a system by which he intends us as human beings to live. And we might call that the laws of nature. Blackstone compared the laws of nature to the revealed word of God, the Bible. In fact, there's an interesting thing in American history I would bring to your attention. A man by the name of Charles Finney, he was an aspiring American lawyer in the early 1800s. In his autobiography, he wrote that he, as it says, like all other law students of that time, excuse me, had to study Blackstone's commentary on the law. In the process of studying Blackstone's, I read so much of the Bible that I became a Christian and I received the call to the Christian ministry. So instead of going into the law, he became a great evangelist here in our country years ago because he was reading so much of the Bible based in Blackstone's commentary. Now that's just simply what the Bible tells us. In Romans chapter 1, this is what we read. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power, and his divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that men are without excuse. Now, it's clear to me that our founding fathers knew and understood that nature's God of the Declaration is obviously the God who created everything. So by this opening statement, we are not declaring ourselves free to do whatever we want. We are free to follow the will of God and free to do what brings him honor and glory. We were declaring our dependence on the Lord God Almighty. This biblical language is very clear if you will just look at most of the information available nowadays regarding American history. In fact, it was so well understood that our country was established on Christian principles. This point came up in the late 1800s, to the point it went to the Supreme Court. Now listen to this. In 1892, the Supreme Court of the United States ruled according to the founders' intent. And this is what they said. No purpose of action against religion can be imputed to any legislation, whether state or national, because this is a religious people. And then they said this, this is a Christian nation. Now, I'm aware of the fact that we've had some politicians in recent years who have said, we're not a Christian nation. But the Supreme Court in 1892 said that we were, and I'm content with that. Now, by speaking of the God of nature in this context, the founding fathers were saying that God is concerned with more than just our political lives or our religious lives. He's concerned with every little bitty aspect in our lives, no matter what we may think. It controls our social, our moral, and our civil living. Yet, let's think about this a little bit deeper here. Is nature's God the God of the Bible? A lot of people like to bring up Thomas Jefferson with this. Now, Thomas Jefferson had some different views than what I do have and what many people in the Christian faith have. I don't know the heart of Thomas Jefferson. But I do know this, Jefferson's religious faith was not the majority of the founding fathers. But when Jefferson was writing the Declaration, he was using the language of the people who had signed that Declaration and who understood it to be that the God of nature is the God revealed in the Bible. Now, is the God of Christianity the God of nature? Absolutely, he is. How do we know that? Genesis 1 through 3 tell us that God created everything. Everything. Not just some of the things. God created everything that is in this universe. But there's even a stronger point to this, I think. In the life of Jesus. We read this in Mark chapter 4. Jesus had been with his disciples. They had been working very hard all day long. They were tired. They needed to get back to their home area, which was on the other side of the Sea of Galilee. So they get in a boat. It's nighttime. And they start to go across the Sea of Galilee. And a terrible storm comes up. Now let me remind you, some of these guys in that boat had previously made their livelihood on that body of water. They knew what the storms were like. They knew that this was a terrible storm. So they go to the back of the boat. They wake Jesus up and they say, Master, don't you care that we're going to die? Jesus stands up and he says, peace be still. The wind subsides, the waves calm down. Mark 4, verse 41, listen to this. The disciples were terrified, and they asked each other, who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him. He's the God of nature. That's why. Jesus could command even nature itself. The God of the Christian faith is nature's God. Jefferson was a man with the mind of a good politician. He wrote and used the words that people would understand and know what he meant by saying that the God who created the vast universe is now creating a new nation unlike any other nation that has ever been. Jefferson was using language that he knew that the Christian people of this country would agree with and understand. We were not rebelling against God. We were following the will of God in this. In Jefferson's mind, nature's God is the God of the Christian faith. So what are some of the lessons that we learn from the Declaration and its God's statements? Why did the Founding Fathers refer to God as nature's God, not our God? Well, the content of the Declaration explains that for us. Nature's God was the God who was giving them not human authority, but divine authority to bring our new nation into existence. If you will read the Declaration, and again, I ask you to do that this afternoon, I want you to notice in sections 6 through 13, you will come across 27 reasons listed specifically of the violations of the King of England with what he was doing against us and what he was doing against the Word of God. And so by referring to this as nature's God, we are part of God's creation and nature. And so therefore that means we are under that authority. Now, today we live in a different world, and we use different words and different phrases and terms, but we're still addressing the very same God. The God who brought us into existence is the God who will help us today with all of our problems, all of our disagreements, and all of the sad things that we see going on today. Our founding fathers were saying, in essence, the God who brought all nature into existence is bringing a brand new nation into existence. Now, we use the same kind of terminologies today. I mean, stop and think about it. If I were to say to you something like this, boy, you know, this summer, old Mother Nature has really been giving us some strange weather. I mean, we started out cool, then it got hot, then it rained, now it's dry. Old Mother Nature just can't seem to make up her mind. Now, that's the kind of terminologies we use today. Now, we speak of nature as having personality, when in truth, it is truly God Almighty who has created nature and who rules all over nature. Many people today would love to separate the Lord God Almighty from our spiritual lives and in their daily lives. There are a lot of churches today that use words and terms, but they're not following the Word of God. One thing for sure, though, there is only one God, and we will stand before Him someday. In Romans chapter 8, listen to what we read. We know that in all things, not just some things, but we know in all things God works for the good of those who love Him and who have been called according to His purpose. Now, what does it mean by all things? It means all things. All things that are under the authority and under the direction of the Lord God Almighty. He's the God of our nature. We cannot deny that. But he's the God over natural and secular things as well. The scripture is abundantly clear here on that. This was the view expressed in the Declaration. And this should help us to understand how we can answer the question when people say, well, what about the separation of church and state? Let me address that just for briefly here. Obviously, the founding fathers of our nation never expected separation of church and state to mean that God has no place in our governmental life. In fact, that statement was not given until Thomas Jefferson wrote it in the 1800s. I've had people tell me, well, you know, that statement, separation of church and state, it's in the Declaration. No, it isn't. I had an attorney one time tell me that the separation of church and state is part of the Constitution of the United States. I said, where? He said, well, I'll show you. And he got his copy out and started reading through it, and he said, you're right, it's not there. Now, where I come from in Stokes County, North Carolina, I could look at him and I said, well, you know, right now you're a suck egg mule. That's about as clear as you can make it. It's not there. And it wasn't intended to be there. Only when you turn your back on the abundant historical evidence, only when you ignore the vast amount of additional writings by our founding fathers, will you ever draw an opinion that we can separate our God from the way we are to live in this country. Our history books are being rewritten nowadays, totally revised. In fact, we've got a problem of today where people don't even know why they're destroying statues and plaques and all kinds of things. They don't know they're our history. If our nation has the authority to exist from the God of nature, then you can be sure he is going to hold us all accountable to him. I'm about to say something that I don't know if you're going to agree with me or not, but I firmly believe this. And I just ask you to listen to what I'm saying. We are all accountable to God. We're going to have to give an account of our lives before God. And I believe that you can sin in the voting booth. Whoa, what do you mean by that? Well, I mean this. If you know that there is someone running for an office who openly declares and announces that they are for abortion and other ungodly acts, if you vote for them, I believe it's a sin. I believe that your vocation is under the authority of God. I believe that your vacations are under the authority of God. I believe that your education is under the authority of God. I believe that your leisure time is under the authority of God. I believe that your social life is under the authority of God. Our founding fathers write that and state such things. And if our founding fathers got their authority from separating from England, from God himself, then there's only one God. And we're all going to give an account to him of our lives. But let me take this one step further. In Colossians chapter 1, this is what we read. And through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. All things again. All things in earth, all things in heaven. There is nothing that touches your life that is not known by God and watched by God. That's why we need to make sure we're the kind of citizens this country needs in order to bring things back to the way they were originally established. God can bring us back as a nation. How do I know that? Our founding fathers knew that we were accountable to God. You are accountable to God. I am accountable to God. We must recognize that so that we know how to live our lives. How do we know? Jesus put it this way. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Now, this passage makes it very clear, folks, that when you give your life to Jesus Christ, you're not only to accept him as your Savior, but you are to accept him as your Lord. You can accept the sacred and the secular if you want. You can separate them if you want. But they're both still under the same God. Let me bring your attention to the closing statement of the Declaration of Independence. This is right above where these men would sign their names. Now listen carefully. For the purpose of this declaration, with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence, there is the fourth God statement, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor. I've had to ask myself, I'm asking you, are you an honorable person? How do you express that honor? In 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14, we read this. If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Now notice how that reads. It says, if my people, this was not a blanket statement to the world. This is to the people who say that we want to follow the Lord God Almighty. If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray. Oh, man, I tell you, today is the day that we need to pray for our country. We need to pray for our leaders, for our president, for the people of Congress, both national, state, and local. Are you calling yourself a follower of Jesus Christ? If you call yourself a Christian, then be honorable. Have sacred honor in your life. Live according to the way the Bible teaches us. Today, as we close this service, we want to give you the opportunity to give your life to Christ. If you've never confessed him before men, as the Bible teaches, repenting of sin, following him, being buried with him in baptism, we want to invite you to do so today. More than that, you don't have to come forward. You can just, in your heart, right where you are, say, Lord, use me. May I be a citizen this country needs, that we might show again that our nation is one God, one nation under God. Would you stand with me, please? As we sing, would you give your life to Christ? Would you recommit your life to Christ? As we say, would you come?
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Jesus. Jesus is calling. He's calling.
is calling. He's calling. Jesus is calling. He's calling. That's right. You may be seated. If you're still in need of prayer, we want to extend the invitation to the altar to you. If you are in need of prayer as you feel called, don't hesitate to come forward. We'll do just that. We'll pray with you. And in the next few minutes, we're also going to invite our servers to come forward. And this will be our time of looking to the cross, remembering what freedom is all about, how Jesus set us free from the grip of sin. The chains have been broken because of his ministry and his works and his love and his amazing grace that he has shown us at the cross, a God of new beginnings. How great then sings my soul. Great is our God. He is great. You may be seated. Pastor.
The American flag has been treated with disrespect, dishonored, thrown aside, burned. By people who do not know what they have been given. That's a tragedy. It bothers me every time I see that. But there is a greater tragedy you and I can commit today. And that is to just go through the actions that we're now about to do without remembering that Jesus died on a horrible cross to pay the price of our sins. So today, as we observe the Lord's Supper, let's remember that the bread represents his body that was broken for us. His blood was shed for us. And let's do this with gratitude and with thanks. As we honor the Lord on this day, let's pray. Lord God Almighty, we humbly come before you, for you are our God. You are the one who has created all things, including each one of us. But you displayed to us a love that is very difficult to comprehend. You went to the cross. You were nailed on that cross. And you paid the price for our sins. May we always honor you, remember you, and live for you. Praying this in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's partake and remember our Lord. Thank you. Now, as our people come forward at this time to receive the offering, let me remind you of this also, that what you're about to do, you're not giving money to the church just so that we can pay our bills. This is an act of worship. You are saying, Lord God, you are worth every penny, every nickel, every dime, every dollar. And we want to see the kingdom march forward. So let's give with a worshipful attitude as we give. Let's pray. Lord, I ask your blessings on this offering today, that as we give, we're not just giving money. We're saying, Lord, this portion of my life in money form is what I value in your kingdom. So may I honor you and worship you in this way. We pray this now in Jesus' name.
Hey, just some information for you. We have some people that are here that will help you and assist you in registering to vote. So maybe you're not registered, but they're not just here for that. You can also change your information if you need to, your address. Or maybe you need a new voter card. You can do that as well. You can go into the Family Center, and they will gladly help you and assist you in there. I think it's an important thing that we, next time around, it's time to vote, it's that we do that. Hey, Bible studies through the week, we want to invite you to be a part of that, to get plugged in. It's great to come on Sundays, and it's good to see everyone, but I think it's good to take it a little deeper and go a little further as we get into His Word in some type of study or small group. So I always want to encourage you to get involved. And I know the ladies are having their thing this Saturday as well, right?
Yes, we have breakfast at 9.
Breakfast at 9, ladies, so come and be a part of that. Maybe lots of bacon. What? You're going to get the guys showing up with if you got bacon. But maybe you're new to the church, or maybe, ladies, you've never been to that breakfast time, and we invite you to do that. Looks like the offering's made its way to the back. You're free to go as you wish, and we love you, and we hope to see you throughout the week. And, ladies, Saturday, don't forget. God bless.
God bless.